Humperdinck, which is phenomenal. And you're also featured on Elvis's album, Look Now, correct? And you're working on your own album. But I'm not going to talk too much about everybody because that's Joe will be doing. Next we have, so first of all, welcome Kitten. Thank you so much for being here with us today.
Thank you for having me.
Really appreciate it. And then we have Matt Katz-Bohen, who I've worked with before on a fabulous music video. Good to have you. Thank you so much for being here.
Matt, thanks so much for having me.
Matt, for those who don't know, is part of he's been part of the iconic group Blondie since 2008 and has toured internationally also with Cyndi Lauper. And he's worked with a host of other amazing people, RuPaul and Boy George, Tony Bennett. That's a good one. Psychic TV, Sharon Needles and Hedwig and the, I can't even pronounce it. Hedwig and the Angry Inch as well. So welcome. Great to have you. And next up we have Joel, or actually known as JK. Welcome. Joel, or JK, is the owner of Pulse Music Studio, and he's a writer, producer, soul R&B guitarist, and amazingly talented man. He's written and produced records with Herbie Hancock, John Forte, who's the Fugees producer, Soul to Soul, The Temptations, Jennifer Love Hewitt, to name a few. There's so many. But he also is an amazingly talented composer for TV commercials as well. So he's laid tracks down on many a TV spot, which I'm sure he'll, like Coca-Cola, Pepsi, Chevrolet, just to name a few. So thank you for being with us.
It's a pleasure.
Great to have you and see you again. And then we have our amazing DJ and music guru, Zen Freeman. So if anybody's ever been to Blonde, to our studios, you would have definitely been hearing Zen's music, because that's basically what we have on his playlist all day long. So we're absolutely thrilled to have Zen with us today. And he's also in LA right now, so it's a bit early for you. Thank you for getting up and being here with us.
Thank you very much.
And just a little bit about Zen. He's a DJ, curator, music supervisor. He's worked with Gucci, Prada, Chanel, Louis Vuitton, Giorgio Armani, Vogue, Cartier, Burberry. The list goes on. It's quite crazy. The Academy Awards, Golden Globes, Sundance, Cannes. He's worked with Leonardo DiCaprio, Elton John, Jeff Bezos and Elon Musk. And his upcoming single, Stars, features Macy Gray and will be followed by collaborations with Todd Edwards, Fred Bouquet, Mr. Hudson, Boy George and Rufus Wainwright. That's quite some resume there. So thank you, Zen, for being with us. And now I'm going to hand over and I'll disappear because we have a fabulous moderator today, and that is Joe Pardavila. Thank you for being here, Joe, and for hosting us.
Thank you.
He is a broadcaster, actor, writer, director, and producer, born and bred in New York City. And he was on 95.5 and has done many interviews with people such as Ed Sheeran, Chris Martin, John Mayer, Lady Gaga, Justin Bieber, Jonas Brothers, Tom Hanks, Kevin Bacon, Mike Tyson, New Jersey Governor, Phil Murphy, and of course, Kim Kardashian.
Sure.
So we've got quite a wonderful group of people today, and I'm going to disappear and hand it over to you guys. Thanks again for being with us. We really appreciate it.
Thank you, Julie. So, you know, as I don't need to state the obvious here, but 2020 has been a lot. So if we can go back to when we all found out when this pandemic hit and shut down the majority of the United States, especially the coasts. I personally decided to move to Charleston, South Carolina in the middle of a pandemic, which I would not suggest ever to anyone ever to move during a pandemic. So just keep that in mind for future ones. But try not to move in the middle of one. It's quite difficult. So let's go back to that first week of March. JK, we'll start with you. Tell us about what you were doing at the time, and then how did your career evolve from that point?
Well, actually, it was a little strange because other than music, the extreme sports thing is my passion. And so I was out in Colorado skiing and having a really great time and not thinking much about anything. And then I got on a plane to come back and everybody was wearing masks. And, you know, I was like, wow, this is looks like it might be trouble, you know. And I leaned over to my friend and I was like, I don't know. I mean, this is not looking great. And 2 days later, my wife, who actually runs an amazing non-for-profit dance program, Celebrate the Beat for underprivileged kids, was out in Denver, and she flew back. And 2 days later, we were on lockdown. I mean, that was it. It happened, like, for us, it felt like it really happened overnight.
And with all your projects, were they immediately canceled, or was it one of those where, like, we don't know where this is going? Let's put everything in a holding pattern. Was it just, was it rip the Band-Aid style? How did you guys handle it?
Well, here's the thing. I mean, you know, we have this company called Pulse Music, which is a facility that has like 7 recording studios. We do film and TV and records, and we kind of all work together. It's a, you know, it's a really great vibe. And we had a ton of projects lined up, and most of them that involved any sort of like face-to-face collaboration got canceled. A bunch of movies we were working on got canceled because they were put on hold. And some of the commercials we were working on got canceled because they couldn't finish shooting the commercials. So, I mean, I've been doing this for quite a while, and I'm sure the whole panel here, we've all had our ups and downs in music. You know, it's not an easy thing to be part of, especially when you're trying to do it at a high level and it's your whole life. And, you know, to all of a sudden have such a drastic thing happen, you know, we've all had either shows or tours or gigs canceled or things like, but this was sort of like, you know, it was going like this and then it just went like that, like immediately. So that was tough. And the way we basically dealt with it is all the guys who work for me set up at home, and we all set up remote recording studios, which is, you know, where I'm sitting now. You can probably see, like, I've got a million guitars in this bedroom. And I basically just set up, you know, the studio in the house, right? And we've all been collaborating that way. And I'm sending files, and we're sending, you know, what the commercials we're working on and the films we're working on. We're doing it all virtually, right? So that's been, you know, it was like a forced immediate change. It was like, okay, figure it out. And you have 48 hours to do it because you're in the middle of 10 projects and your other 10 got canceled. You know?
Wow. And Blonde was nice enough to invite a Brit. We have Zen here. Zen, obviously been here for a while, but you probably have people back in Europe who are, you know, you're close with. You saw this coming long before a lot of us Americans even thought it was going to be a thing. Tell us how things developed for you, Zen.
Actually, I was in the States for most of the time during the progression of COVID-19, but there was some, you know, there was Art Basel, I guess, and, you know, there's some things going on. I can remember being in New York and Miami, and there was a lot of talk in Miami, and, you know, there was people wearing masks on planes, but it hadn't really hit LA. And then I think that it really didn't affect me until the very beginning of March. There was a lot of talk. And then in November of last year, I partnered with Ian Schrager, The Edition, and the Marriott, and a financier group. We very successfully opened a nightclub on Sunset Boulevard called Sunset. So kind of operating a nightclub and dealing with all the talent that were coming in there, and my own, you know, I was obviously playing there a lot. On March 12th, we decided to kind of take a pause and shut down and cancel that weekend out of our own decision. And then very quickly after that, you know, the government stipulations came in and we shut down. For me, the next phase was me as an artist. And then I get a phone call from my agent at William Morris. And he basically just said, wipe the slate clean. Everything's gone. You know, there's the fashion brands, especially, kind of, they furloughed a lot of their staff. So, you know, the events got mostly canceled. Touring all got canceled, clubs. And then there's some really nice, like, private events for weddings that have all just keep getting pushed. And, you know, celebrity birthday parties. This poor girl, it was going to be her sweet 16. Uh-huh. Millie Brown from Stranger Things.
And oh, yeah.
It went, you know, now it's going to be her probably her 18th birthday. I think the new date is 2011, end of summer or something. So, you know, I guess it is what it is. And then on the, you know, and then on the flip side, the production just all became virtual, and I haven't seen a recording studio since, you know, but you know, the second week of March now.
You forgot what it looks like.
But yeah, but good things are happening. And, you know, JK and I had a really long chat about this. The music that you can do virtually, and the amount of creativity and the responses and people actually having time, and, you know, people would all, you know, artists, that writers that just normally wouldn't be available to write are writing with us. And so, yeah, it's been, you know, it's been shocking and, you know, creative, all in the same beat. And
great. Now, Kitten, I want to ask you, because this is supposed to be a big year for you, because you're working on your debut solo project, American Refugee, and then all of a sudden this little pesky pandemic comes in to throw everything off. What were you in the middle of the planning stages of the album drop? Were you just finishing it off? What was going on at the time?
Doing multiple things, actually. I've been working on this record for a while now, but I was actually in England on tour with Elvis. We left at the top of March, I want to say the end of February, top of March, when we started to hear more about this coronavirus thing. And I had a feeling this seems bigger than what they're making it out to be. And while we're on tour is when things start to lock down back in the States. And England hadn't completely gotten the memo, like they were kind of really loose with it.
Yeah.
And then I was hanging out with some friends in a pub on, I think, March 14th or March 15th. And I got this email that was like basically effective immediately. Everybody has to go home. The band, you know, the tour is cut. Everybody has to go home right away. When we flew into LAX, it was crazy because it happened to be like a very dark and rainy, stormy day, which is atypical.
Yeah, for very LA, cinematic. You know? Yeah.
So it's like, and as we get there and everyone has the masks on and, you know, they're taking your temperature and it's just really somber. And there's this, it was very apocalyptic because they didn't even have all the lights working at the airport or something. Mm-hmm. It seemed very dark. And there were more people that worked there than actual, you know, people flying around. And it was weird. We weren't sure if we should still be on the road while we were out there in England, because while the rest of the world was like, oh my God, panicking, we were still, some of us were still doing shows. It wasn't a big arena show. So there was less people, but we started to wonder like, is this a good thing to do? Cause we were still selling out the shows. You know, people were still on top of each other. When we got home, it was like night and day. And they had the announcements about make sure you're wearing your mask and da 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 da. And it was really crazy. And so pretty much everything had to be put on hold. We were supposed to do like the Jazz Fest, the New Orleans Jazz Fest, and all these other things. Everything got pushed back, canceled. My record that I was working on, that all kind of, you know, kind of got pushed back and pushed down. So, and then you have to start thinking, like everyone else is saying, you have to start thinking differently about how you're going to approach the music, how you're going to approach this industry, how are you going to figure out how to make money or still connect with your peers, being that we're all isolated all over the place, you know.
Wow. And Matt, you being part of the band Blondie, what were you guys in the middle of? Were you guys about to hit the road? Were you guys planning a tour? What was on the horizon for you at the time?
Yeah, we had a tour, I think, all of May and most of June. We were going to do a U.S. tour that was going to go down to Mexico. So, you know, needless to say, it was promising to be a great tour. That's actually how I met Kitten, was when Blondie and Elvis Costello did a co-headlining tour. I believe it was last summer. I think it was last summer, 2018. Yeah. So Blondie's a great band to tour with. And yes, so when I got the news in March, I was actually playing a show. I had a show March 12th with my band, Princess Goes to the Butterfly Museum. And we were playing Mercury Lounge. And we were excited because we had sold out Mercury at our last show. And we were like, oh, this is cool. We're going to sell it out again. And then we were like, why is it only half, you know, capacity? Yeah. And obviously you know, things were getting weird, but it was still kind of normal. But we were kind of like, should we play this show? I don't know if we should do it. And we went ahead and we played the show. And then that night, the next band canceled. They were like, we're not doing the show. And Mercury announced they were going to shut down. And I think all the clubs basically that the next day decided to shut down of their own volition. So I think it may have been one of the last club shows in New York City that we played. Princess.
And you mentioned Princess Goes to Butterfly Museum, and I got caught in a rabbit hole when I was looking at your Instagram, and I see your band, and all of a sudden I'm like, the lead singer of that band looks like Dexter. I don't know if that's is that him? And then I'm like, oh yeah, that's Michael C. Hall. He's the lead singer in your band, right?
Yeah, that's him. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Has he always been in bands? Because I know he's in musical theater and television and film, but how did this come about?
Yeah, it's funny. So he's been in bands in high school and college and whatever. And then he pursued theater. I met him when I was doing Hedwig back in, I did Hedwig in 2016, 2017. I was the assistant music director for Hedwig.
And he played the lead, right?
He was Hedwig, yeah. And it's funny. Actually, I didn't connect with him then, but then a year later, my friend Peter, who was the drummer in Hedwig, and he was also in a band called Morningwood. He founded that band. I don't know if you guys know Morningwood. But anyway, Peter and I were jamming, and he was like, hey, I should play this stuff for Mike and see what he thinks. We played it for Mike. Mike was like, I can't help but notice you guys don't have a singer. And we were like, yeah, you want to do some singing? He was like, hell yeah, I do. So he sang, and it was, I think we were all sort of mutually surprised at how fun it was and how well it clicked. I was terrified of Mike for the first month or two that I met him.
Well, sure. You, Dexter, you don't want him, ended up in a kill room, covered in plastic. I get that. By the way, I love the song Vicious. I saw the video for it. It has a very David Bowie-ish vibe. I'm not sure if I'm way off on that, but it's a great song.
Thank you. Yeah. Mike actually got kind of close to Bowie toward the end of Bowie's life. He played Bowie in Lazarus and Bowie's musical.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah. So they spent a lot of time together. So I feel like he got some of that Bowie juju, definitely. Totally. And obviously we love, we're all massive Bowie fans. Yeah. And, I never got to work with him or anything like that, but, spiritually perhaps in some sense.
That's awesome. You guys are all obviously super talented. It's pretty silly for me to be here, but the one thing about creative people, you guys need sort of inspiration to create. And the kind of common joke for people who aren't in the creative space, they're like, well, this pandemic must be great for creatives because they could just sit home and write and create all these amazing things. And I almost feel like saying to people like, that's not how that works. Like even Lin-Manuel Miranda, I don't know if you guys saw, he tweeted the other day. It's like, it's okay not to feel creative right now. We're all processing the same thing, whether you're a creative type or whether there's a regular person who just enjoys consuming media. So just a question to the panel. Have you all, any of you, felt creative at all or any inspiration during this process? Doesn't sound like any of you guys have.
I think everybody's waiting for the other person to say something.
Oh, yeah. I agree.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it depends on the situation. There's so many different things happening because there's the pandemic and there's all the civil rights things. So there's so many different levels. So one day it's kind of like, the bored in the house, sitting in the house, bored kind of feeling. And then there's other one that's like, fight the power, fuck this shit. It's kind of like, so the emotions change day by day. And sometimes you're just completely emotionally tapped out. Right. So like at the height of things, you would think people would be like, oh, I'm just like getting into it and being so creative. And sometimes you're just like, I just need to be in a dark room and right. just lay down. And
did you feel like from the time of the pandemic to when the George Floyd murder, did you feel like did you feel like creative juices flowing, or all of a sudden did you feel like once that happened, it sort of something came out of you about it, because you are an activist. So I don't know if that inspired you more to be creative as opposed to being in a pandemic and, just eating Cheetos all day or something like that,
Cheetos, the vegan kind.
The vegan Cheetos. Yeah. I forgot you're vegan. Right.
No, actually. Yeah. The George Floyd thing initially it was just kind of like, I am very just gutted about it. And then after that, it kind of inspired more, you know, like it's my forthcoming project is called American Refugee. So this kind of dovetails directly into that concept of where do you go as an American if you don't feel like you belong here, or you don't feel like you're cared for here, but then you can't just magically jump and be a part of another culture and be accepted as one of them, or you know, you're always still gonna be an American wherever you go somehow. So it's kind of like this whole concept, the whole George Floyd thing is, you know, he was an American citizen, you know, minding, doing his thing, whatever he was doing, whether you are about what he was about or whatever, he was still an American citizen that didn't get the rights that he should be afforded as an American citizen. So like I said, that kind of just dives directly into the concept of the project that I'm working on. So it was inspiring in that way, but it can also be overwhelming because, you know, as you pull back the layers, you find out about more issues that are happening in this world that have to do with civil rights, you know, and I've been pretty much aware of a lot of those things, but it's so much, since it's so much more on the surface now, it's harder to hide, and it's everywhere. So on the one hand, it kind of makes me feel good in a way that people are able to see things that I've been seeing and feeling. But at the same time, it breaks my heart that it's still happening, that people have to see this, people have to go through this. So in that sense, yes, there has been some level of creativity, but it also has been very exhausting.
Yeah, I bet.
To what Kitten said is that, you know, it's, I'm working on a film right now with the actor Leon, who was in The Five Heartbeats and all these movies. And we've been really dear friends for, you know, for the longest time. And working on this, I have to say it was really inspiring because it's about, you know, it's about racism, and it's called We Will Thrive, and it's going to come out soon. And it's about, you know, it's about racism, and it's about how Black and brown people have thrived, right? Despite this insane oppression that's been happening for centuries, right? And so in a sense, right, in a sense, I think that, you know, we're seeing for the first time, I feel, at least since like the 60s, a sort of seismic cultural awakening, for lack of a better word, right? Where at least the conversation, like you're saying, Kitten, is really on the table, you know, like nobody can really hide from it. And even the people who are on the wrong side of the aisle, right, and they're on the wrong side, they're so wrong, and it's so obvious that in a bizarre way, I think that's a good thing, because then everybody else who was a little asleep at the wheel can see just how, you know, horrific, like in our country, right? I cannot imagine that the president is tweeting that Black Lives Matter is a hate organization, you know? Like the level of absurdity, right? So in a way, and I don't know if this, you know, if the analogy I'm about to draw is even valid, but in a way, right, whenever there's some kind of change, there is creativity involved, right? Whether it's social creativity, whether it's musical, whether it's theatrical, whatever brings things to people's attention, right? And so for me, I think that in a sense, the COVID situation enabled me to sort of pause, right? Because I've been always so busy. And Zen, we talked about this a little bit the other day. Remember, it's like, we're just always just the next thing, the next record, the next film, the next this, and then running home to be with my kids. And then we're doing, you know, and it's sort of allowed to say, not just who do I want to be as a musician, right? But what impact do I really want to have on this planet, and for my friends, and for, you know, and for people who have been oppressed, you know, really, really oppressed. And so it's opened up, I feel like, a whole other side of creativity, right? Like I'm working on I had done a solo record for Verve, right? Which had been very much sort of like George Benson meets D'Angelo or something, right? It was super soul, but a lot of guitar playing. And I reconnected with my manager, who's a really incredible guy, David Pasek, in the whole jazz world. And I'm doing a new record now. And this made me take a big shift because I was in the middle of it. And then even though I thought the music was pretty banging, I was like, you know what? This is not really what I want to say. I mean, it's like, because most of it is vocal as well. And I thought, this is not like, how many more, you know, great groove love songs do you need? You know, like, you gotta just kind of dig a little deeper. And so I think that it's going to open up an avenue, you know, for all of us who have been doing this, you know, to maybe dig deeper, maybe go further. And by having the time, right, is that, and by having the studio at home and everything else, it's allowing me in a more sort of, I don't know, maybe consistent way, that if I'm listening to something or hearing something, to just be able to go right at it and call a friend, or, you know, I'm going to be collaborating with Zen, and I would love to, obviously, with Matt and Kitten as well, for sure.
Not me.
You know, well,
no. You know, nah, it's fine.
You know, but to do those things now, in a, even though it's so not organic to work through the computer, yeah, in a way, it's more, there's an organic point to be able to just connect like this via video and say, well, I've been listening to this girl, I've heard her sing before, she's rocking, you know, let me connect. So I think that's sort of what we're all kind of weighing, I guess.
And Zen, you obviously, we talked about the number of projects you had going on at the beginning, and I'm sure being so prolific sort of fires off a lot of your creative synapses in your brain because you're constantly processing information. Has this sort of pause in the world like slowed you down in your sort of creative process, or in a way, has it sort of reinvigorated you to think about the next step?
Well, I think, I mean, when it first happened, you know, work obviously relates to income. And at first it was like, you know, first reaction. I think second reaction was, I can remember spending about 3 hours on the phone to American Airlines trying to like, hey, I've got this, you know, I've got this flight next week. I've got flight Thursday, Friday, Saturday, let's do this. And I start putting all the flights on hold or changing new dates. And then, and then it really kicked in. JK and I were chatting last week, and it's first thing to do, you know, I would always try and balance my time between work and family, but obviously when you're away for 3 or 4 days in the week, it's hard. It's been so effective just being at home and being able to connect quickly, you know, scheduled or, you know, spur the moment sessions, having the time to do just the kind of work on the music that you're really interested in, stuff that you do for you and not for any clients or not for a sound that you think that, you know, just because you like it. And then on the flip side, actually having time to really spend with my kids. I just, you know, I mean, I messed up before, like it's been amazing. It's been a really great pause on that side. And then to channel that energy back into, you know, once you're comfortable and you're happy and, you know, I'm eating breakfast, lunch and dinner at home, waking up saying, you know, good morning, good night to the kids. It's really important. And it's just something that I was really missing, really like not knowing it, but just constantly burning the candle at both ends.
Yeah. And Matt, with you having two bands essentially working at the same time, how has that sort of worked the creative process between your relationship with both of them?
Oh, which bands are you referring to?
Well, I guess Blondie and the Michael C. Hall project you're working on.
Oh yeah. Yeah. So Princess Goes, Blondie, and then Cyndi Lauper too, actually, which has been, luckily there's never been a conflict, which is kind of crazy for the last couple of years. And everyone's cool and friends, supportive of each other.
You're like a musical swinger. You're going all over the place. Yeah. I love it. That's fantastic.
Yeah, yeah, I'm a total whore, swinger, polyamorous.
Nothing wrong with it.
Yeah, I mean, people, you know, a lot of musicians I admire are just like, they're like, yeah, I'll work with everyone who I like, you know, who I appreciate. So I always, I kind of like that style. But yeah, we were supposed to play the DNC, the Democratic Convention with Cyndi, which I was really looking forward to, which obviously is not happening, I don't think, as far as I know, unless we do it via Zoom, which there was actually talk about doing a remote concert. And I was like, yeah, I'm cool with getting in SIR studios and wearing a mask and whatever, or not, you know, just we're all distant from each other.
Or you can play for Trump. He'll let you be as close as you want.
Yeah. Go right to Tulsa.
Yeah.
Oh boy. No, thanks. That's a pass.
That's a job you'll say no to.
Exactly. That's where he draws the line.
The other ones, bring him on. Trump, nah, I'll, it's a hard pass.
No. Can't do it.
But have you been able to, so I guess talking about those three different bands you're working with, have you been able to collaborate with them during these 3 months and be able to create something?
Yeah, actually, with Blondie, we've been doing stuff for a new album. So we've been doing the remote thing, you know, throwing ideas back and forth. Cool. And I keep thinking to myself, what would it have been like to go through this pandemic and lose all the work pre-internet, you know? Yeah. What would that have been? Like, we would have been recording little reel-to-reels at home and then sending them in the post office to someone, you know, I guess. So it's very lucky that we've been able to throw a lot of ideas around. And I think, like everyone's saying, everyone's kind of just itching. You know, creativity has its ups and downs, and you know, we've all been affected by, you know, George Floyd and everything. But I feel like, yeah, everyone's kind of ready to get back at it, you know, definitely ready in some way.
We got some questions coming in, so I'll read a couple of those. This is from Hannah, and we'll go around the room because obviously you guys are all pretty experienced. And this is, she says, thank you everyone for speaking today, enjoying the conversation. What are some networking tips for beginners? So obviously networking is a big part of any business, but the entertainment business more than ever. So Kitten, any networking tips?
Networking tips, it's interesting because we're in this era of social distancing. So before, networking could include going to certain kinds of jams and stuff, or certain artists would have, you know, events at their house and you can meet people, or there would be certain kind of conferences that you could go to, or going to lunch or having a coffee with somebody. But now we don't have that physical interaction. We don't have that access to just go sit in a venue. So I would say at this point, network through social media, send a direct message to someone that you'd like to work with and communicate with. More than likely they're around. They might be more prone to respond to your messages. So I think that's one way you could do it during the pandemic.
All right. Do any of you gentlemen have any other non-social media ways to network right now? Is there anyone have anything?
Just to stay on that topic though, sorry. I've actually had a lot of conversations with quite big artists that said they wouldn't normally respond or have time to respond to direct messages from, you know, from fans almost, or people trying to collaborate. And it's definitely his time, because there's people, you know, there's really big artists that are just, you know, almost a little bit bored and looking for, you know, they're looking for stuff to do.
That's good. Matt, JK, anything?
I was just gonna say, I think another good thing, I mean, I agree with Kitten, like most of my networking has happened in person. But I think one of the things that is really cool, if you're starting out and you're doing something interesting, like do something musical and send it to that person. Because the guys who have gotten hired by my company, right? And some of the people that I've collaborated with, you know, even on some of the bigger projects that I've done, right? Ended up not being the quote unquote, you know, big stars or whatever. And two of the guys we have that are working now at the company, who are honestly superstars, started off as interns. And one of the guys just came in one day and said, hey, can I play something? I was like, sure. You know, and he played it. And like, I mean, my head, I did a 360. I was like, what? I mean, the guy was ridiculous. Like, he was just beyond great. And like, I think, and also, you know, I think that now, and I hope I'm right, I'm getting this from my wife, who's like eternally, you know, the sort of like optimist, and she's vegan, of course, like you. So, but she's like, you know, basically, she's like, you know, I think that this whole COVID thing has also made everybody like maybe a few notches nicer, you know, and getting off that, that pedestal sometimes that people can get on in this business, you know? Yeah. It's just like, hey, you know, everybody eventually wants the same thing, right? Which is some success, a good life, some good relationships, you know? And so my attitude, and I think I've always been, you know, pretty good with this, but my attitude is that if somebody has something really cool to share, bring it, you know? And I think that would be the advice that I would give. You know, if you're doing something cool, send it to the person, you know, with a nice little note and ask them to check it out. And that might be a great way to connect.
That's cool. And Matt, you obviously with three bands, you're probably the master at at networking. So do you have any wisdom you could share about that?
Yeah, I mean, that sounds really great. I mean, I love the idea of reaching out to people who you respect and love in their DMs, you know, and, you know, I'll get things occasionally and I love it. I always love listening to random people's music. Like, oh, here's someone in Spain. Mm-hmm. I never would have known about, and they send me something and it's really cool. So, I'm going to do that now, actually. Thanks, JK. That's a great idea.
I'm gonna send you some stuff, man.
Yeah. I think somebody from Spain or Italy sent me something too. He DM'd me and sent me a track to listen to and stuff. It was pretty good. So
I've gotten no messages from Spain. So just wanted to share that.
Okay.
We got another question. This is from Jasmine, aka Jazz Rock Sandler. And I guess it's more of a crystal ball type question for you folks. When do you guys think performances will be back? I host events and bring in other musicians. Planning has been rough and online shows aren't big revenue generators. So Kitten, let's start with you because you were in the middle of a tour when this happened. Have you spoken to any of the people you've been touring with, or is there anything even written in pencil in the near future?
There is nothing written in pencil. There was a lot of hold the dates. And then all those things have dissolved. So I know that in the UK, some of the artists that I know or musicians that I know are working with artists. They're doing drive-in
performances.
Yeah, drive-in performances. And I don't know if you've guys seen the recent Dave Chappelle show. He mentioned the last show he did before that one was a drive-in one. And people just kind of honked their horns when they thought was funny. I do not think that would go over very well in America. Because A, we don't like to be told what to do.
Yeah.
And B, we can't handle not honking the horn at something.
Right.
So, but I don't know. I mean, I just don't know when they would come back with America with this pandemic thing. California, and I'm kind of happy that I'm not there right now, but California is starting to shut back down. So it's we're just kind of riding on this wave. So as far as I know, there's nothing on the books. There's no forthcoming weddings to sing at. There's no, I haven't heard of anything whatsoever. I mean, it's mostly just been, I had a couple friends that did a televised benefit thing. I think they were kind of social distanced out and they, you know, but as far as touring, as far as live shows, I don't know when that's coming back. I hope soon. The last forecast that I heard was fall 2021, and that cannot be true, please.
Yeah. So. And now, Zen, your handlers told you to clear your books, but have they told you to stop clearing your books or add this here and there? I mean, anything?
I mean, there was a mad few days where, yeah, it was like the slate is clean, but it was a long time since I really didn't even speak to the guys that, you know, helped me get my bookings and things, but there was actually an offer that just got confirmed yesterday in Venice, Italy for the end of next summer. And I've got a couple of bookings actually for quite high profile events in the US or in Europe for summer next year.
Oh boy.
Which, you know, I mean, and I was kind of, you know, used to, you know, playing from very small to big, you know, 300 shows a year. The ones that are confirming are definitely the more boutique style, you know, someone's perhaps like a destination wedding for 150 people, but there's nothing of scale that's confirmed yet. So, you know, we don't really know what the is going on at the moment.
Wow. And Matt, you had mentioned that Blondie had, I guess you guys were going to be traveling in May and June. Has there been any talk of, hey, let's try to strike up the band in early 2021? Anything like that?
Sadly, not in terms of touring. I wish I wish there was, but yeah, everything has been kind of wiped clean for 2020. All the tours have just been postponed indefinitely. But you know, like I said, the recording thing we were talking about. So we're sending things remotely, I guess, with the idea of getting into a real studio at some point. And doing, you know, full band, actual studio record. So that's something that will be, we'll have to just wait and see.
Hmm. And JK, anything with you?
Well, I mean, we, you know, there's, I think there's sort of different facets of it. We, last year we were just starting, but we got a label deal through through Orchard Sony. And we were going to put out a record of a band that I have called Ruby Black, which is sort of like a cross between like Prince and Earth, Wind & Fire. It's really cool with some of the greatest musicians in New York and featuring some amazing vocalists and all that. And we finished the record, but then that got put on hold. So we're trying to figure out, honestly, different ways, like how can we still do this? Because, you know, like Kitten said, it doesn't look, I mean, it's just not, you know, until this thing is under control, I don't think it's realistic to expect that live shows are going to happen because, you know, like my actor friend Leon says, hey, do you want to be at a Knick game and have some beer guzzling guy start coughing at you and like two inches away? I'm like, you know what? That's a good point. Not really. I think I'll watch a Knick game on TV. So it's kind of that. It's like, so I do think that we have to, you know, one of the things that I kind of learned early on, it's with your downtime that if you use that really, really intelligently, then your on time will be, you know, way better, right? Yeah. So I think it's going to be sort of like on all of us to figure out how can we make this time really productive in some way. Right. Yeah. And I think that if we do, there's going to be good things that come of it. And I do think like music, you know, for me, I'm sort of ready for it to change. Right. Because I feel like, you know, pop music's been dominated. It's sort of like, you know, it's a reflection of politics. Right. Yeah. You've got like fast food politicians who are morons, you know, running the country. And you've got, you know, really kind of sappy, crappy, I don't even know what to call it, right?
Yeah.
Stuff going on. But then you have all these artists, and I think people with a pent-up desire to hear some people really who can sing and who can play and who aren't dependent on an auto-tune and a guy sitting behind his computer for a week to make it sound even tolerable to listen to. Mm. You know what I mean? So it's like, I do think they're ready for real artists, real musicians. You know, I had a chance to check out Matt's band, and it's just cool stuff, you know? And it's like, you know, that's what I'm sort of hoping. Like, I don't really have a direct answer to when have a direct answer when there's a vaccine and we can control this, right?
Yeah.
But in the meantime, I really do believe that it's about, like, I'm trying to stay focused on what can I get done now? What kind of content can I prepare? How many songs can I write that are really, you know, have some merit and we can do something with, things like that.
Right.
I want to jump in real quick
to
his point about the people wanting to hear like music with dynamics and that kind of thing. I think that's something that allows me to have hope that we will be able to get back to doing the music, because right now everybody's kind of stuck at home. They're not really getting a chance to feel that energy, right? And so when we're making and able to create some music with organic elements in it, that's just kind of bridging the gap a little bit to make them feel a little bit connected to the humanity in the music. And so then when we finally open up, I think people are gonna be just chomping at the bit, whether they have money or not, to try and see live performances. And so I'm hoping and holding on to that hope that when we do open up, then touring is gonna like just really be in a different swing.
You know, you guys know this, and probably people watching may know this as well, that for a musician or someone in the music industry, a large portion of your revenue comes from live performances. So, you know, in the business world, if you watch CNBC or any business channel in the last 3 months, you would get drunk if you played the drinking game of every time someone says the word pivot, do a shot. So how are musicians like yourselves able to pivot and find other revenue streams? Are there options for you guys to be like, all right, I'm not going to be able to, like we've said, it almost sounds like generally you guys don't feel like there's going to be any live performances in 2020. You just get that feeling. How can you guys pivot for the next, say, 6 months, to be kind about it? Can you guys pivot in a way in the next 6 months to find another revenue stream to help you along the way to get to the other side of this pandemic and unrest and everything that's happening in the world? Kitten?
I've been making some instrumental things and getting them submitted to, you know, small films and that sort of thing. So that's a pivot that I've been able to do. Lending my voice to some background stuff, that's a pivot. It's not the same as live, you know, stuff. One of the things that I used to do was I used to substitute teach for Culver City Unified School District in LA. My mom's a teacher, lots of teachers in my family. And that's not a pivot that one can do, right? But yeah, as far as musical, just kind of doing stuff in your home studio and submitting those things out is a pivot that I've been able to do.
And how about you, Zen? Because, you know, obviously a lot of your work, you know, is live performances, but you also have the digital aspect of creating stuff. Are you able to create stuff for commercials, or is that an, or you may already be doing that already?
Well, I mean, obviously, a lot of the income, you know, is probably a good 90% was coming in from touring or doing, you know, I was doing some digital stuff, but it was, you know, even it was, you know, producing music for installations. The installations were for a launch of a new fashion brand, which obviously isn't happening now. Or so, yeah, I mean, it was as soon as, you know, beginning of March 12th, slate wiped clean. What the hell do you do now? My first thing was to kind of like, well, how do you live stream? Like, let's go buy a camera. Let's go buy, how do I connect my iPhone to the Pioneer DJ mixer? How do you do the lighting? And that was kind of interesting. And then, you know, I saw a lot of really, for March and, you know, March, there was some incredible live shows on Instagram and Twitch. It got really, really interesting. And then I just think it was, you know, Kitten kind of mentioned this earlier. Second, George Floyd murder happened. It just kind of kicked the wind out of everything. Because it was almost like I wasn't making any revenue from IG, but I was touching all my clients, and, you know, I was on, and you know, at one point I'm streaming on Instagram, getting kicked off every 45 minutes for publishing. But one point, you know, there was 26 people on, and there was Calvin Harris and Pete Tong and Paul Oakenfold and an actor called Aaron Paul and Paris Hilton and all these kind of really wacky, wonderful, lovely, amazing, you know, people I know. And it was almost like just a really good way of getting out some stress and like, I don't know what the hell's going on. I don't know where the money's coming from anymore, but let's have some fun. And, you know, and then I think it went to that, you know, and then, you know, and then, you know, now I think it was time for all of a sudden. And I noticed so many artists stopped streaming the second that George Floyd murder happened. So, you know, and then it's more, you know, how, you know, back to business, and how do you pivot? I just started making a lot more music, but at the moment it's, you know, my channel would be to go to an independent record company, sign a single, maybe an EP, and then just watch it go out. And it's, as an artist, it's sometimes a little bit like, for music that's not hugely successful, it's a little bit sometimes the feeling of making art and then flushing it down the toilet.
Yeah,
you see it go out, and you know, I put a track out called Hungover. I put it out on Tomorrow Music, which formerly was Ministry of Sound Australia, and it got a good, like, it got about 100,000 streams in 2.5 weeks, which is pretty good. but it doesn't equate to any kind of value whatsoever. You know, I think you start getting, you know, you start seeing at least $5,000 on a million streams. Yeah. So at the moment, I think, yeah, the smart thing for artists to do is just to figure out what works, but also figuring out ways to, if you could just kind of concentrate on 1,000 fans and go direct to consumer, you could make a living from that.
Yeah.
You know, so I think it's all, you know, I think it's time, pause, time, strategy, obviously, is probably most important. Making music at the moment has been great and really easy. Now I'm just trying to figure out, like, do I really want to sign everything away and just give it away to a label?
Yeah. And Matt, so, you know, obviously you've got the three bands. So how are you able to pivot, or are you still concentrating on trying to, you know, create with those three factions, or have you been able to find other ways to generate some revenue?
Yeah. Yeah. So with Princess Goes to the Butterfly Museum, we have an album that's being mixed right now. Going to come out probably in the fall, September. And, so there's some income stream that comes from recording, and I, you know, have songwriting, and I can, you know, there's still an income stream from that too. But yeah, I mean, I have friends of mine who are starting up Patreon. And I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. Like a way to go directly to your fans.
Audience. Yeah.
An audience, and they get to decide how much to support you per month, which is amazing. Like, you could just do $1 a month or $100 a month if you want, you know, and you have the money. So I know a few touring musicians who've been getting into that, and it seems kind of really cool, I've got to say.
So, that's awesome. That's great. Cool. Yeah,
it's also a paywall for anything that you do. Sorry to... But yes, Patreon looked really, really interesting.
Cool. And JK, you know, we mentioned that you had the studio, but you're also a musician too. But is film and scoring, is that sort of your sort of primary pivot right now?
Well, yeah. I mean, it's the for us, the one thing is that we were not really relying much on live shows, because the core of our business has been producing music for film, for TV shows, for commercials, and also, producing records as opposed to going out and playing live so much. So the pivot now is that, you know, it's a little bit the same problem as everyone else on the panel, is we've got this big music company with a lot of people who work there, and we're used to doing a certain volume of work, right? But now companies are not shooting commercials the way they were because of COVID, right? Yeah. No crews want to go out and do this new content. And it's the same thing with a lot of the TV shows that we do music for. They're on hold, right? A bunch of the series and films are on hold, right? So, you know, the pivot is basically, again, like, how do we keep that going at a certain level when the other parts of the industry have sort of come crashing down, right? It's a matter of, like, how creative can you be? And one of the things that we're doing is, I've been involved, again, with my friend Leon in developing some TV shows, right? So we've kind of switch part of our focus to doing that, to getting those things done and ready. So like Kitten said, when that pent up, you know, need and desire is there, we're already ready to go, right? So I think there's a lot, I feel like there's a lot of opportunities now to sort of rethink how you do it. And maybe as artists, especially touring artists, what you guys just mentioned, Matt and Zen, it's like a there's gonna be new models, because if you think about it, when you and now having, you know, had some experience having an ownership in the label, if it costs you $30,000 to promote so you can get a million streams, but you only make $5,000 from it, it's really not a great model, right? I mean, it's sort of like, okay, hey, I got a million streams, or I got 5 million. That costs me five times more than I make, right? So I think that for us, we're trying to use, you know, our, you know, cumulative acumen to figure out, well, you know what, maybe there's just a better way of doing this, right? And I think, Zen, you made a great point. Like, if you focus on X amount of fans, right, and grow that organically, that's how you're gonna, you know, I mean, I have a bunch of, you know, guitar player friends who are, you know, you've all heard of, right? You know, who are just some of the most amazing guys on earth. But they did it in the organic way, right? One club at a time, one state at a time, one bar at a time, one college at a time, right? So I think the key is going to be unlocking, how do you do that virtually? Like, how do you really, how do you connect? How do you see, how do people, you know, do that? And so our pivot is that we're trying to figure out what that could look like, honestly, because the other stuff we're already set up to do. So we're doing it, obviously. We're doing whatever projects, you know, we have or do come in. But I think it's really sort of figuring that out, right? Because the one thing about Instagram, and I think I have like 1.5 followers because I just joined, but I resisted the whole social media thing. Actually, I think I may be up to 80. It was a big day 2 days ago.
You'll be up to 90 by the end of this.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't posted anything. I haven't done anything. However, I'm into it because now I'm seeing, like, when I go on Instagram, okay, I see these amazing guys. You know, I had the good fortune of working with Herbie Hancock and playing with him and producing his record. And he's, you know, I mean, Herbie's got to be like 75 or something, and he's posting, like, these great things. And so it really is this wonderful way of seeing, you know, someone else do something, someone else play. So clearly, you know, I'm excited about doing that. And I'm working on a bunch of content to start posting, actually, of me playing or some of the things that I'm doing. But, you know, I know, like, Zen, you've had this experience. We've worked with these amazing talents, right? So how do you take it from the studio or from live into this arena? You know, and make it really entertaining and make it something you can monetize, you know?
You know, anytime I do interviews or anything like that, I always like to end up on a happy ending, I like to say. And, you know, we've had some moments of levity, but had some heavy moments. So as we wrap up, I want to talk about what's brought you guys joy. What's inspired you? What's happened in your lives that you're like, you know, over the last 3 months, this happened. It could be something as simple as I read an amazing book, or I saw this movie, or a friend, this happened to a friend. Give us some joy as we, you know, as we talked about the difficulty of being a creative person in this world. And, you know, obviously we're all kind of going through no matter what you do for a living, but has there been something in your life, or it's anything you're able to share, you know, just something that everyone could be like, okay, yeah, I feel that too. Like, for example, like I wasn't reading much before the pandemic, and all of a sudden I've fallen in love again with reading. Like, I'm devouring books. So that to me of the pandemic is my takeaway. Like, oh, cool. I'm reading again. I'm educating myself. I'm learning about history and about other famous people. So what have you guys found joy in the last few months? Or if there's maybe something that you saw in the news or something that happened to someone in someone's life that really sparked you and said, oh my God, this is why we're here. So Kitten, if you don't mind.
Two things stand out for me. One of them is, you know, being able to be creative and kind of left alone with that at times has been really great, you know. And sometimes you have that idea, like, I have to hurry up, I have this deadline, or I have to wake up at a certain time. But knowing that you could just be in the studio and lock yourself in there for however long, because no one needs you, has been great. And another thing has been these sorts of dialogues. I have been asked to be on a few different panels during this. And I haven't, when I was in college, I would create panels and have people and entertainment people come to my school and talk and stuff. But it's interesting how I've been now the person that's been asked to be on these panels. And these panels have been very exciting for me. I've been able to meet new artists and other creatives and share ideas and share inspiration. So it's a way to feel, to still feel connected to the industry and still feel connected to your colleagues, still feel connected to your calling without having to actually go to a place. And that's something that I felt that I would miss with the pandemic, you know, like how I was saying, I'm very physical, as you could probably tell because of all this stuff. I'm a very physical person. I'm very much like, I want to see you in person. And so this has been a great bridge for that, to be able to, you know, meet all of you all and reconnect with people. So those are the two things that I can think of offhand.
Cool. Matt? You're muted, Matt. I knew it was going to happen to somebody.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry about that. The dog, you know, I had to mute it. I feel pretty lucky. I'll start with my kids. I have two kids, age 5 and 8. And getting to see them every day and hug them has been huge. You know, I have friends who have not hugged another human in months. And they're like, I don't know, when's this ever going to happen again, you know? So just having them has been incredible. Aside from that, I mean, you know, the seismic change going on that we talked about, seeing all the Confederate statues coming down has been amazing. You know, I think we can all appreciate that that's happening. We have a long way to go, obviously. And then finally, the last one is learning Japanese. I've been, every day I wake up and I sort of meditate, and then I spend half an hour with Japanese. And I gotta say, it's just an incredible mental escape. And it's also a mental kind of, just a part of your brain you don't use every day. You know, I've never used that part of my brain. So I've been getting really into that.
You can pick a harder language to pick, a, you know, Klingon or something. I mean, geez, that's, yeah. I hear that's a very difficult language.
The written is insane for us Westerners because of the kanji. It's like thousands of characters. And yeah. Kitten, you do Japanese too.
Yeah, you know? Japanese was my minor in, I was like two classes away from a major. So we should practice because I haven't done that.
Hi, Nihongo ga hanashimasu yo.
Hi, watashi mo hanashimasu.
Ah, so desu ne. Yeah, we gotta do it.
That's cool. All right, and Zen, how about you? Do you learn any languages or anything like that?
I actually got the Duolingo app for Spanish. I've been kind of doing a little bit, but I'm not. But yeah, it's a good app. But I just think having the time for me is just the most important thing that I didn't realize that I needed, but I needed. And I think I needed this more than I needed income because, you know, the scary thing about being a touring DJ is there's no income coming in, but it's so great. I'm reading books and, you know, working on myself and playing sports. And Matt, you know, waking up every morning, giving the kids a hug, it's priceless.
That's awesome. And JK, you've got the last word.
Well, I mean, I'm going to echo what Zen and Matt said. Like for me, being with the kids has just been incredible, you know, and, you know, to be able to hang out, like my son came in the other day and he sat on the bed while I played guitar for like an hour and a half. And, you know, that's just priceless, you know, asking me questions and just the ability with them to be able to go out and play basketball in the middle of the day or, you know, go for a bike ride and just hang out with them has been, you know, it's been really, really amazing. So that would be, you know, the first thing. And to hang out with my wife, who's my, you know, best friend, and just, you know, we're always on the run and she's always traveling. I mean, I don't think we see each other more than a week a month, if that. So that's been, you know, really cool. And then I think that, again, echoing what you guys said, is I think the ability to reconnect with all these people that I had not, you know, been connected with, some of these amazing friends and musicians that maybe we did an album 15, 20 years ago, and all of a sudden, you know, we've reconnected, and I think it's put people in that, you know, in that place, right? And I think that's really just a wonderful thing, you know, it's reconnecting with people, and also, you know, I think what Matt said is so true, you know, that, I mean, there's so much, you know, that's left to be done, but to get involved, you know, with making a change, which my wife and I have been really actively doing lately. It's just a good feeling, you know, because it's one person at a time, right? And if you can make a contribution, at least I think it's a start, you know? Yeah. So I feel like that, you know, that's been really fulfilling. And yeah, just connecting, you know?
That's great. I think we're going to be like totally super scion. I don't want scion, but you know what I mean? Like just superly transformed, enlightened beings by the time this thing is over. We'll be reading books and learning Spanish and Japanese and more compassionate. Maybe we'll eat a salad.
Yeah, I don't know about that. I won't eat a salad. No salad from me. But Kitten, Matt, Zen, Joel, thank you very much for not only taking the time to join us today for this Blonde Talk, but also being so open. Because I think the one thing, as we've been socially distanced from each other, luckily with this technology that we've all been sort of like shitting on for like the last 10 years, like, oh, there's too much social media, there's too much of this. The one thing that we can say that's come of this time is that the social media and technology has helped us all stay together and doing talks like this, even though some people may feel like some sort of Zoom fatigue. The more of these that happen, the more that people can hear your stories and more can understand what you're feeling. I think it makes it, going back to what you guys all said, it just makes the world a better place. And I just want to thank you guys all for your time and sharing that today.
Yeah. Thank you.
You're all so amazing and talented. And thanks, Joe. You did a great job.
Thank you very much, guys.
Yeah. Thank you.
God bless you all. Bye now.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Hello, everybody.